title of our lesson is Care of the Body. How important is our body in the service of God? Is a question that I think what we're going to be studying on. How important is the care of our body to the service of God? Let's look at our memory verse there. I'm going to read it, and then we'll run into it a little later there. For ye are bought with a price. For ye are bought with a price. Therefore glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's. I'm not going to say nothing right now on that, so we'll come. But remember that, 1 Corinthians 6:20. Junior emphasis, God gave us our bodies to use for Him. They do not belong to us, talking about the body. Do you know your body don't belong to you? That's kind of a funny feeling there, you know, that your body don't belong to you. Well, that's my body, you know. People will say, that's my body. Well, it says here it don't belong to you, but it belongs to God.
That's right.
That's something to think about. You know, us humans don't have very much, you know, that's ours, you know, that we can actually call ours. But yet the worldly people, you know, their body is their body, is theirs. Their wealth is theirs. What they have is theirs. The job that they have is theirs, you know. You know, that's pretty me oriented, isn't it? You know. But, you know, us as Christians, we recognize that our body is not our body. We're using this here on earth. God gave it to us to use here on earth, and He can do with it whatever He wants to with it. But it says, our bodies do not belong to us, but belongs to God. He lets us use them for a while. He lets us use them while we're here on earth. There's a sentence there in the adult emphasis. It is sin to use the body either to commit sinful acts. It is sin to use the body either to commit sinful acts. It's sin to use your body, to use the body that God gave you to commit sinful acts.
Sure.
You know, that sentence right there kind of blowed up at me, you know, when I read that. You know, our bodies was created and allowed us to use our bodies for what? To glorify Him, not to blow ourselves up or not to think ourselves something great. You know, a lot of people has got a lot of me in them, you know. I mean, they think a lot of theirself. And yet, you know, God could have allowed their bodies to be different to where it would humble them down or where they couldn't get around as good if he wanted to. And you know, Paul and I was talking here the other day at how, being grandparents now, how we think, we've got five grandchildren, and how each one of them is different, but each one of them is perfect, you know. I mean, they don't have a disability. And how thankful we are, we was admiring how thankful we are that each one of them has got five fingers and five toes on each hand and foot. And you know how God allowed our grandchildren to be perfect grandchildren, you know, in that respect. And you know, because other people hasn't got that fortune, that they that some of them are maimed, you know, don't have a, don't, you know, might be missing an arm, or got a cleft lip. Have you ever noticed, have you ever seen a child with a cleft lip, you know, how it really, really, you know, makes them look different, you know, and children, you know, will tease children about that, you know, because that's the way children are. They're, you know, they'll bring out something like that, you know, and all. But, you know, I am so thankful that God gave us grandchildren that are so perfect like that, and I appreciate that. Let's go on into, but our bodies are very important instruments for us to use. We have to have our bodies to be able to use it in a way that God wants us to use it. You know, maybe some of us has an ability to do some things where others don't have that ability. But you know, God knows exactly who's got the ability to do what.
That's right.
You know, if you think back, you know, Moses, God called Moses, didn't he? God called Moses. You know, you remember the situation where there was a bush burning, you know, and Moses, he looks over there and he don't think too much about it at first. He looks over there and it's not being consumed. He says, well, let me find out and see what's going on there. And he goes over there and then God speaks to him and he calls him to be a leader of a people to bring them out of Egypt, the Hebrew people, to bring them out of Egypt. What did Moses say? What was Moses' excuse? Well, my tongue don't work like other people's tongue, you know. Yeah. And so God says, I've got that figured out for you. He says, you got a brother, Aaron, and he don't have a problem with his tongue. And he says, he's going to be your spokesman, you know. God has an answer. No matter what excuse we come up with, God's got an answer for it. He wants us to use our bodies in a way that will glorify Him, and to treat these bodies in a way that will glorify Him too. Let's go to 1 Corinthians there 6:12. All things are lawful unto me, but all things are not expedient. All things are lawful for me, but I will not be brought under the power of any. Let's stop right there and let's take a look at that. Not under the power of anything. Some say the Bible says nothing against this or that. Why can't I do it? You know,
sure.
Why can't I do it? Paul wrote that even though some things are lawful, he would not be brought under the power of any of those things. Mm-hmm. You know, the sins, the pleasure of sin for a season is not worth losing your soul for eternity. It is never a good trade. You know, that's what Moses said. Wasn't that what Moses said? Sins for a season. Who was that that said that? I may be wrong there. But anyway, it's not a good trade. It seems like a good trade at the time, but think about eternity's a long time.
Amen.
Eternity's a long time. If something's in question, do without. If you think, well, I don't know whether I could do that or not, then, you know, that may be the conscience, your conscience pricking you, saying, no, don't do it, you know, because it's better not to do something that you kind of question about. And it's best not to do it.
That's right.
Some things like tobacco, alcohol, dope, and others have power over a person. Mm-hmm. How? Well, they form habits. They form habits. I've talked to a lot of people that are smokers, that have smoked. And they have smoked for several years. And they said, if only I knew. I was told this, they say. But if only I knew how habit-forming cigarette smoking is, I would have never started. But they have started. They have been smoking for a long time. They don't realize how much it drags their body down. They don't realize how much until they quit and are off for a while. And almost every one of them, I'll ask them, I'll say, don't you feel better now than when you were smoking? And 99% of the time, I can't think of the ones that I was told any different, they tell me, yes, I feel a lot better now than I did when I was smoking. Yeah. Wow. Every one of them has. I know several people that I work with that has quit smoking, and they'll say the same thing. Why start the thing, if you haven't started smoking, why start it when you see this? That don't take a whole lot of common sense to figure out that here I am 60 years old, I've never smoked, and I'm not going to start now because I've seen what it will do to people, you know. Smoking, alcohol, same way. Alcohol. That first drink, I would say 99% of the people that took that first drink and then that became alcoholics didn't think they were going to be an alcoholic.
That's right.
When they took that first drink. No, it's not going to happen to me, you know. But it does happen to people. Yeah, it may not happen to you, but it happens so much of the time. And it takes away from family time. It takes away from God's time. It takes away from the family and financially. It takes away from the family in every sense of the word that there is. It takes away. But these things will get the power over you. They will get a grip, a hold of you if you allow them to do that. And most of the time it is through the form of a habit. You've probably seen this illustration of how it's hard to break a habit. You know, I've seen it before. They take a person and they'll take a string and they'll wrap it around their hands, you know, a couple, three times, you know. And, you know, it's a light string, you know, and you break it. You know, you can break it. But then after years and years, and you wrap and wrap and wrap around there, and you think, oh, I can break it, just like Samson, you know. Well, I can break it, you know. And pretty soon it's got a hold of you, and you can't break it.
That's right.
It's wrapped so many times around you that you can't break it. And the longer you go, the more that wrap gets around you. More it does. It's just a little bitty old string, but it just keeps wrapping. You know, just like a fly in a spider web, you know. You know, if a fly gets caught in a spider web, you know, first web, you know, he might be able to get loose, but boy, when that spider gets over there to him and he starts winding him up, that's his dinner. That's that spider's dinner, you know. And it's the same way with habit-forming drugs like this. It's the same way. A person becomes a servant. I like to say a slave to them, to these habits. I mean, I've got a guy that I work with that's a smoker now. And try to get him to miss a cigarette, he don't never forget that. You know, I mean, it's automatic. I talked to a guy that quit smoking and had been quit for quite a little while, and I asked him, I says, is there anything that you do that you you know, think that's different, you know. He said, here's what he said. Here's what he told me. He says, I find myself, and he said he'd been off cigarettes for probably 15 years. He says, I still feel myself reaching up here, reaching in my pocket. Yeah. He says, I still reach up there. Well, there ain't nothing there, you know. He don't smoke anymore. But after years and years and years of smoking, he reaches. Now, that's slavery, isn't it? You know, to reach up there and get that. Why can't we get into a habit of reading the Bible like that? Wow. Or praying or something like that, you know, something useful like that. If the devil can get a hold of us like that, let's let God get a hold of us in the right way. And it'll be a whole lot better. It'll be a whole lot better. A lot easier on the body.
Sure.
You know, smoking or reading the Bible, which is better? I think that's pretty easy to figure out, isn't it? Drinking or reading the Bible? Drinking or praying? You know, I think that's pretty elementary, isn't it? Person becomes a slave to them. God wants us to be free to serve Him. And you know, that will not be a slave position if you get in the habit of reading the Bible. Well, I've got to read my Bible. Well, now, yeah, if you look at it that way, then yeah, it probably will be. But, you know, if you say, well, I'm going to read my Bible today. I'm going to, you know, just like any other day, I'm going to read the Bible, see what I can get out of it. Now, is that more being free than being slave to it? Yeah.
I've got to and want to get the same end result as far as reading. I've got to read my Bible, or I want to read my Bible. But the outcome could be entirely different.
Uh-huh.
If you just got to do it,
uh-huh,
or if you want to do it,
uh-huh,
I think you get a whole lot more out of it if you want to do it.
Or if you got to, well, I'm checking off. Feel like I gotta read three chapters, so I'll check it off. I'm good for today. The next day come, well, I gotta read three chapters. You know, that becomes a bondage to us rather than being free. I want to read it, and you know, sometimes I can be reading the Bible, and you know, I kind of pick about three chapters. That's what I usually do. And you know, sometimes I've read four or five of them, you know. Or sometimes I've only read one, and I think, well, I haven't done my duty, you know, of reading the three chapters, but sometimes that's what God wants us to read, you know. And you know, we have to listen to the Holy Spirit.
Sure.
We have to listen to the Holy Spirit, because sometimes it won't be quite exactly what we had planned. A lot of times that happens, yeah. God wants us to be free to serve Him. It is wrong to use anything which has power over us. Anything. That can be anything to have power over us. Okay, we read that first verse. Let's read that next verse then. Meats for the belly, and the belly for the meats, but God shall destroy both it and them. Now the body is not for fornication, but for the Lord, and the Lord for the body. The body is for the Lord. The belly and the meats are both to be eventually destroyed. They will.
That's right.
They will. You know, my body is not going to, 200 years from now, my body is not going to be here anymore. You know, less than that, but I'm just setting it out there that my body's not going to be here anymore. It's going to be an empty shell, if that even. It might be, probably look more like Ezekiel's Valley of Dead Bones. Ezekiel, yeah. I thank you for correcting me on that. But the dead valley of dead bones. You know, there wasn't nothing to it. There was just bones, and that's it. That's probably what my body will look like 200 years from now. But you know, because it's not going to last. It's not going to last that long. Now our spirit, it's a different thing. It's a different thing. We should live for what will last. Our spiritual things. Mm-hmm. Put our affections on spiritual things, you know. And we should do that. Not to satisfy the fleshly appetite. And you know, that is where people get in trouble quicker than anything. Is appeasing, satisfying the fleshly appetite.
That's right.
Jesus had a temptation of appeasing fleshly appetite. When the devil told him, turn these stones into bread. That would have been appeasing the fleshly appetite, wouldn't it? Because he was hungry, you know. But no, he would have been following Satan. And Jesus says, no, get out of here. Man is not to live by bread alone, but by every word proceeding out of the mouth of God. And not only the appetite of your stomach, but also the lustful appetite of your body. The body, he goes on and says, the body is not for fornication, but for the Lord. It is to be used for him. This is the Corinthian people here, and they had a problem with a lot of sins that were rather nasty.
True.
Rather nasty sins. And that's the reason why Paul brought this out here. But it's just as fitting for us to keep this in the back of our mind and out front so that we don't fall into the same problems as what these Corinthian people did. How many ministers has fallen into the sin of fornication, adultery? There's been several of them. These are ministers. We might put them kind of on a pedestal, you know, more, you know, that, oh, they shouldn't do that. Well, guess what? Us lay people shouldn't do that either.
That's right.
You know, it's just as important for us people that are in the congregation to keep ourselves pure and away from such sins as is mentioned here too. The fulfilling lust, whether it be lust of the flesh, lust of the eyes, or the pride of life, fulfilling lust is not a good thing.
Amen.
It's never a good thing. Let's go to 1 Corinthians 6 and 14. I'm going to read that one verse there. And God hath both raised up the Lord and will also raise up us by his own power. Here is a wonderful promise. God will also raise up us by his own power.
That's right.
By his own power. At the resurrection, all dead bodies will be raised to life like the Lord was raised. See how much God cares for our bodies? You know? Do you see how much? We also should care for them, because God has lent our bodies to be used by us. And you know, he's given us the opportunity to use it in any way we want to use it, but he has a plan that how he wants us to use it. You see what I'm talking about? Yeah, we can go out and drink and crowds around and do all kinds of things. That's our option. But that's not what God intends for us to use our bodies for. He intends for our bodies to be used to glorify and serve Him. But He gives us that opportunity. It's just like we have the opportunity to be saved or not to be saved. It's the same thing. God's will is He wants us to be saved. I mean, that's just pretty simple, isn't it? To be saved. But He allows us to choose what we want. Same way with our bodies. He allows us to choose, but He has a way that He wants us to live by. See how God cares for our bodies? We also should care for them. God has a great work for them, or for our bodies to do, for us to do. And we have the thinking behind that body also. See, our thinking correlates with what we do.
That's right.
All in what we think stems from what we do. And sometimes we might put on a front and kind of deceive people in what we're doing. But God, you can't deceive God.
Amen.
God knows. God knows exactly what your purpose is, what your motive is, and what you're planning. And He knows exactly. And so it's all up to Him. It's all up to Him. How are you going to please God? How are you going to live for God? It's up to you, but God knows exactly how it all works out. God knows exactly what you're thinking. Okay, now let's go to verse 15, and I'm going to read to 18. Know ye not that your bodies are the members of Christ? Shall I then take the members of Christ and make them the members of a harlot? What's the answer to that? God forbid. In other words, absolutely not. That's what he's talking about. What? Know ye not that he which is joined to a harlot is one body? For two, saith he, shall be one flesh. But he that is joined unto the Lord is one spirit. Is one spirit. Flee fornication. Every sin that a man doeth is without the body. But he that committeth fornication sinneth against his own body. Our bodies are members of Christ. Your bodies are the members of Christ. They belong to Him. They belong to Him. Remember, I told you that to start out with. They belong to Him. The body belongs to Him. You just got it on loan for a little while. It belongs to Him. My hand is not mine. Well, yeah, I can control it. I can do whatever I want to with it. Yeah, you can. Yeah, God gave you that liberty to be able to do that. But His intentions is to work for Him. Mm-hmm. Give Him that. Give another saint your hand, a fellowship. Sure. That's what it's for. Not to slap somebody. There's different ways you can use that hand, And so my hand is not mine. It is Christ. Can I take Christ's hand and harm it or to sin with it? We can, but it's not what God wants us to do. So with all of my body, if it is His, That's, whether it's your foot, whether it's your tongue, ears, whatever, If I use any part of it for things not the Lord's work or pleasing Him, I am stealing from Him. I am stealing from Him. Does anybody want to be labeled as a theft, as a thief?
No.
As a theft, as a thief? No, nobody wants to be labeled as a thief. Everybody likes to be labeled as being honest and upright, right? Yep. So, but if you don't use your body in a way that God wants you to, then you're a thief. You're a thief. That's what it's saying here. Yep. Should I take a member of Christ and give it to a harlot, a wicked woman? He says, God forbid. That's what the scripture said.
Amen.
Absolutely not. No, never. Rather, we should be joined unto the Lord. That is the most important thing, being joined to the Lord. You know, there is a lot of carousing and stuff going on, especially on the weekends. You know, it's a lot of these honky-tonks and clubs and all that kind of stuff that should not be going on. And you know, a person can fall into that if he allows himself to do so. Mm-hmm. I mean, just like smoking or drinking or narcotics or any of that kind of stuff, this can be a habit-forming mess too. Is running around with a woman that is not your wife, running around with people that you shouldn't be running around with. Rather, we should be joined unto the Lord. He wills that all should be saved. We should give him our body and soul and all. Then his spirit and our spirit will be one spirit. That's the important thing right there. Being one with Christ. Not one with a harlot,
no, but
one with Christ.
Right.
One with Christ. We must flee fornication. Flee fornication. You know, if you first sight of fornication, first sight of that mess, turn and go the other way. Flee fornication, shun it like it was poison.
Amen.
Like it was the plague. You know, you've heard that expression. You know why? For it is. It is. It is a sin against one's own body. It is a sin against God. Think about Joseph. Little 17-year-old Joseph. Well, that's kind of what I set him as 17 years old when he was sold down into Egypt. Think of that little fella, 17 years old. I may be off a year or two, but I don't think I'm too far off on that. And, you know, he caught the eye of Potiphar, you know. And he said, man, this guy's got it together. This guy's got it together. I'm going to make him, you know, kind of the head over my house and everything. I think he knew more about his house than Potiphar knew, even. You know? And then, here comes Potiphar's wife, you know. Now, she's married to Potiphar. Or she wouldn't be Potiphar's wife, would she? She's married to Potiphar. But she catches an eye for Joseph, you know. Joseph wouldn't have nothing to do with her, you know. And, you know, and I don't think it just happened one time. I believe that he had to resist several times, and then one time was when he left his coat. She caught a hold of him and left his coat, you know. Nothing that he done. And then a false accusation was brought against him. He winds up in prison. But this little 17-year-old fella, you know, did what God wanted him to do. He had some upbringing. He knew what was right. He knew what was wrong. He knew that his body was for God. And that having an affair with Potiphar's wife was not the right thing to do. Even though he was clear down in Egypt, well, he was way away from his family, you know. Way down there, they would have never found out nothing about it, you know. But he knew better. And, you know, we need to do right even when we think that we are not going to get found out about. Now, that's pretty, you know, we tell that to children, you know. But, you know, that's something that we need to keep in mind ourselves. Even when we think that we're not going to be found out, we know that God knows what's going on at all times, and he is with us there. You know, so many times we can, you know, people will say, you know, this is my body, I can do with it whatever I want to do with it, you know. Well, I wrote that up there at the top, and after that I put W-R-O-N-G. Wrong. We can serve God with it,
sure,
but we have a way that we can serve God too. God is not always pleased with the way some people serve Him. So we have to dig into the scriptures and find out the right way to even serve Him on that. Let's go to 1 Corinthians 6 and 19. What? Know ye not that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost which is in you, which ye have of God, and ye are not your own? Memory verse. For ye are bought with a price. Therefore glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are whose? Not mine, not yours, but God's. The body is the temple of the Holy Ghost. Your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost. It was made for the Holy Ghost to live in. Now, isn't that a great opportunity for us? That God thought enough of us to create us so that the Holy Ghost can live inside of us? Isn't that a privilege? You know, that we need to count that as a great privilege. That the Holy Spirit can come and live inside our bodies. You know, that is a wonderful privilege that we have. If we are saved and spirit-filled, He's in us. He's in us. If we are not saved, be saved and let Him in. That's the answer to that.
Amen.
You know, you don't have Him if you're not saved. And if you're saved, you have Him.
Amen.
And if you want Him, you got to get saved.
That's right.
That's pretty simple to put, ain't it? You are not your own. And how many times have I said that this morning? We're not our own. We're not our own. God made us, made you, made me. God made us. When Jesus bought you with a price, or then Jesus bought you with a price, the price was His death. Now He paid a high price for that. And if don't ever think that that was a high price. That was an extremely high price. And we are fortunate that Christ came and gave His life so that we can be brought back into fellowship with God. How easy is it to submit our body, to submit ourselves to God for such the high price that Christ gave in order to buy the plan of salvation?
Right.
It's very much so. We all owe ourselves to Him. Christ paid the price. And what we are doing is letting Him take control of our lives. Because we don't know how to do it. You know, if you say, well, that's a bondage to allow ourselves to be brought under Him. Well, we tried it before, and that really put us in bondage.
No.
That's not bondage.
No,
that is living. That is living. When we turn ourselves over to God, that's what you call really living. We must use our bodies and our spirits to glorify God. Why is God against habit-forming drugs in the body? Now, this is a question I'm asking. Why is it? Here's my answer. He wants a sound body to serve Him. You know, if you're smoking and, you know, you cloudy and one thing and another in your mind, you know, you don't have a clear mind. If you're drinking, say you're drunk. Say you come to church drunk, you know. You don't know exactly what you're doing. You don't want that. God doesn't want that. Okay, what if you're high on drugs? You know, that's the same thing. You know, you're not yourself. Things will alter your attitude, your character, your being. Things, drugs like that will alter your being. Okay, now, let me give you an example. If you have a car that's sluggish and not running, not hitting on all cylinders, are you pleased with that? No. Well, that's what we are if we come to church high on drugs or whatever. We're that sluggish car, you know. First thing you do, misses, it dies, it's not hitting on all cylinders. What are you going to do? Well, I need to take that thing to the shop, get it running again, you know. Well, that's the same way we are to God. Let's make sure our car's running right, you know. Let's make sure that all the soot and stuff is out of us and ready to serve God. Yes, I know when you come to Christ, you might be a smoker. You might be a drug addict. You might be a alcoholic. But you know God can clean that up.
Amen.
God's the mechanic that'll clean that car up and get it going again. And so we can be thankful for that. 1 Corinthians 3:17, if any man defile the temple of God, him shall God destroy. Now, you hear that? You know, God's going to destroy that. For the temple of God is holy. Which temple are ye are? Which temple ye are? It is wrong to defile the body by sin. You know, there is so many things that the body can participate in that is wrong and not what God intends for it to be. There is so many things that can be done. You can get straightened out, and then you can turn that body around and use it for God in so many different ways, which is a whole lot more pleasing to God and a whole lot more pleasing to yourself too. But let's look at this here, punishment for defilement. If any man defile the temple of God, let the dirt of sin or of harmful things spoil his body, him shall God destroy. Mm-hmm. And it will. It will. That destruction will be in hell. How terrible. Saints, keep your body as something very precious that God has allowed you to care for and use for him.
Amen.
He has put it on loan to you. Remember, we said that our body is not our body. It's not our own. It's not our own. But he has allowed us and put it on loan. Now, how are we going to take care of it? Are we going to treat it like a temple of God? Or are we going to treat it like it's just something that God gives us to have pleasure with? No. Keep your body as something very precious that God has allowed you to care for and use for him. Keep it holy, for the temple of God is holy. He can't live in an unholy temple, can he?
No,
he can't and he won't. Never take anything into the body that will weaken it for God. Do not smoke or drink or use drugs that form habits. Take care of your health. Never do with your body anything that would displease God. Use your hands, feet, ears, eyes, tongue, mind, heart, and all, if I miss something, to glorify God. You know, there's a last sentence in the commentary there on the adults one. It is not a sin to be ill, but it is sin if we willfully make ourselves ill. You know, I think every one of us has experienced being ill this past month.
Sure.
And so, you know, if it was wrong to be ill, every one of us was wrong then, wasn't we? But no, that wasn't it. Now, if you caused yourself to become ill, then now you might have a problem. You probably got a problem then. But I don't think not a single one of us did that. And you know, we caught that bug or that crud or whatever you want to call it, you know, and we were ill. We had to go through times that we didn't feel good. But, you know, I think some of us even caught it a couple of times, you know. You know, maybe three times. I don't know, but, you know, that's a trial that we had to go through.
That's
a trial. We still glorified God. We still were happy in the things of God. Even though we didn't feel quite up to par, we was kind of like that sputtering car, you know. But, you know, God understood that. And when there was no sin involved, God understood that. And, you know, that was a trial that we went through. How are you going to treat that trial, you know? That's a lot of it. How are we going to treat that trial? No, you know, Romans 6 and 16. Know ye not that to whom ye yield yourselves servants to obey, his servants ye are to obey, ye obey. Whether of sin unto death or obedience unto righteousness. This refers again to being brought under the power of someone or something. We have one master, and that's Jesus Christ. We must keep free from our relationship that which would hinder our service to Him. We do not want to hinder our service to Christ in any way. Not in any way. The best that we can be. Be, what's the army? Be all you can be? Well, let's be all we can be for Christ. Let's be everything that we can be. Let's not shirk on any of our duties or whatever. Because God wants us to be wholehearted and full-hearted for His service. I'm going to read Romans 6 and 13. It's not in there. Neither yield ye your members as instruments of unrighteousness unto sin, but yield yourself unto God as those that are alive from the dead, and your members as instruments of righteousness unto God. It's a lot like verse 16, but it was written in verse 13. So it's kind of a repeat is what it is there. But it's not exactly word for word, but it's means the same thing. And let's go to Mark 12 and 30. And thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart and with all thy soul and with all thy mind and with all thy strength. This is the first commandment. You know, someone asked Jesus what the greatest commandment is. And this was the answer that Jesus gave him. You should love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, soul, mind, and strength. That don't leave very much for anything else, does it? That sums it all up. How can we do this? How can we do this if we live a wild and rambunctious life? We can't. We can't. Our heart will get clouded. Our soul will get clouded. Our mind will definitely get clouded. And our strength will be offended or be affected also. And so we have to really concentrate on the things of God so that we can be what Christ wants us to be there. That first and greatest commandment. Self-respect in your points to consider. I'm going to read that. If there were no other reason, self-respect should be significant to prevent fornication among both saved and unsaved. People do not commit this or any other sin as long as Christ abides within. You know, I don't think none of us has a problem with fornication and adultery or anything like that. But you know, it can creep in. And you know, we have to be very careful. We don't want anything. Now this, to us, this is a big sin. You know, fornication and adultery is a very big sin. That's, you know, we seem to put degrees on sin, and that's one thing that I do. It's very, very big sin. But, you know, we can change that. Fornication or any other sin, and we can, you know, even the little things. It's the little foxes that'll spoil the vine. It's the little foxes. So we don't want anything. We don't want this. We don't want anything. We want to be in tune with God at all times. Our next lesson is going to be on tobacco, alcohol, and narcotics. So I guess we'll get a double dose of that then.